You've got those cool, clear eyes of a seeker of wisdom and truth. I believe in you. I believe in you.
Bathtubs in America.
There are 105 million television sets.
There are 59,572 millionaires.
There are 3,552,000 unemployed.
We eat 10 billion hot dogs every year.
2,146,000 people get married.
999,000 get divorced.
15,000 people get murdered.
A new American is born every 8.5 seconds.
But our dreams,
like grains of sand,
and all the stars,
cannot be contained in numbers.
If I gave you today a tax-free holiday, would you want to go away? Southeast Asia,
an interstate dream come true. What do you think you do? Could you take a look at you? Or wouldn't it faze ya? The kids are getting crazy, now you better believe it.
Papa says the sun, you gotta love it or leave it. Drinks on me, America. Living in the city's like dying in a cage. You got your bouffant hair and your minimum wage.
Take free rides, America. Come by bus.
I'm the great American dream machine. You can clip me out of any magazine. Anything you want for a nominal fee. Maybe you see me on your color TV.
The great American dream machine.
say what's on the dream machine, Daddy?
We'll miss medical center.
Oh, just for a minute. It's interesting.
Probably a lot of hairy hippies crying about how tragic Vietnam is.
Well, it makes you think about things.
If you ask me, it's depressing.
And as we approached the village, there were a number of people standing on the outside edge of the village. And all of a sudden, the point element of the squad just opened up on these people and started shooting them.
When I got there, the company had been there a number of hours. The sun was shining.
And there were women and kids there, and we were firing them up.
And it was over in, I don't know, it's hard to tell time, 2 minutes, 4 minutes. And I looked up, and it was quiet. And every Vietnamese on the beach was dead.
I got some banana ripple ice cream. Want some?
I don't know. My stomach's acting funny.
I'll put some almonds on it.
Okay, three scoops. Do you with these creeps on TV? Spiro ought to see this.
My name is Dan Notley. I'm a resident of St. Paul, Minnesota. Presently, I'm a student at the University of Minnesota majoring in photojournalism. I'm a Vietnam veteran. I spent 13 and a half months in Vietnam as a combat infantryman.
My name is Bill Marhoon. I was drafted in November of 67, went to basic training at Fort Campbell, radio school at Fort Benning, jump school at Fort Benning, where I became a paratrooper, went to Vietnam with the 173rd Airborne, and served in Vietnam from April until October of 68.
I'm from St. Paul. That's the winter we went to Hawaii. Do you remember, dear?
What's your work?
That was when you won the sales contest.
Swell. This year I'm going to the poorhouse. Damn car needs $200 work, did I tell you?
We've got to pay the orthodontist this month.
How can I eat if you're going to nag me about the bills? No wonder my stomach's a mess.
Well, take a Bromo.
I did already.
Just a little jumpy. You want a tranquilizer?
Three today already, I had.
If you could just get a raise, that'd solve everything.
Forget it, I told you. Sales are way off. And he keeps screaming, you gotta make your quota, you gotta make your quota. How, I'd like to know. Competition's murder, they're killing me.
But most of the guys in my unit were in a contest, a body count contest, to see if their squad, their fire team, they personally, their company, could get a higher body count than anybody they might be competing with. And it was good to kill, and they loved it.
I don't know. Charlie seems to be doing okay. He got a raise and a promotion.
Charlie's lucky, and he cheats.
Solo, you need a raise to pay the bills. To get a raise, you need more sales. More sales, you get a raise and a promotion. So cut some little corners. Everybody does it.
These commanding officers are interested in getting their promotions. And to get a promotion, you have to have a high efficiency report. In order to have a high efficiency report, you have to have a high body count. And they don't give a damn where you get the bodies. They tell you we want to go.
Oh, you like that cheese dip? It's new.
Yeah, good. We're out of that strawberry-flavored popcorn, though. I like that. Any cake?
Do you ever think of growing a beard, Daddy? You look nice, someone, I think.
Nice. More like a damn queer, for God's sake.
What about Lincoln? And Jesus?
That didn't work for my company. I've got an image to maintain.
Those boys seem very sincere.
Bums, if you ask me.
He was brought up in an average home. Both of my parents are Southern Baptists. It was a conservative upbringing. My parents are both very good Christians.
A fairly decent life and good home and all this. Christian upbringing. Lived in a all-white area.
Did you ask for your raise today?
You know, there's a big thing.
How'd you forget again?
I asked. You know what the SOB said? There's a recession, he said. Effective. Lucky to be working at all, he said. Guy's gonna give me a trauma. Why does everything have to happen to me?
And I was so upset. It was such a traumatic experience for me. And so confused at what was going on that I was really afraid for my own life that if I didn't cooperate or if I didn't commit myself somehow to some degree, that I too might possibly become a victim. And so I pointed my M79 at the people and fired one round, and I never know whether I knew whether I hit anyone or not, because immediately after I fired, the rest of the squad opened up, and from there on, I just refused to participate. I didn't say anything. I just didn't participate. I just watched, and there were I estimated about 30 people that we killed in that village.
When I got back to headquarters, I asked my CO if he'd heard what happened on the beach. And he says, yeah, we got 26 VC. And I said, sir, they weren't VC. They were our friends. They were Coke girls, shoeshine boys, mama sons, babies.
Guess who called today? Old Joe Santi. He was in town.
Who?
Old Joe Santi. I told you, we were in the army together. Old Jivin' Joe from Kokomo. I told you lots about him. Of course, there's lots I can't tell you.
You told me. I know. The good old days.
Yeah. I didn't know how good they were. Gee. Those war years were really swell. Such memories I got, Eunice. Warm, you know.
Well, it's heavy. It weighs on you. You know, I carry around this big bag of guilt, you know, all these people I helped kill. And a few I helped kill directly.
Did I tell you I saw a mugging this afternoon on the way driving home?
Oh, no.
A guy just grabbed off this old lady's purse. You should have seen her expression.
Well, what did you do?
Nothing. Are you kidding? What's the percentage? You just get involved. Besides, the light changed.
The reason I didn't report it was because everybody in my chain of command already knew about it. My squad leader took part in it. My platoon leader sent us in there. He was in there the next day and saw the bodies. My battalion commander was in there the next day and saw the bodies. Everybody knew about it. The whole battalion knew about it. So who the hell was I supposed to go to, you know? Nobody. Well, I couldn't go to anybody.
My. More me lies. You'd think one would be enough.
Don't they know people are bored with this massacre junk? I followed the whole Cali trial, and look what they did to that poor devil.
We should know what's going on, Daddy. We're registered voters.
Cali was just doing his job.
But they did say he killed innocent people.
Me and my job. Running, worrying most of the time, smiling and joking at a lot of people I don't even like. On a day. I'm not going to sleep tonight, I can tell you.
I just really can't seem to function. I've got to get it off. I've got to... Listen, when we were there, we were killing people all the time. Innocent people, most of them. And we're still doing it, and they're still dying, and I can help stop it. And I can't be guilty any longer.
Television ought to entertain you. Who needs all this downbeat stuff?
If I'd have had anything in my stomach, I'd have probably thrown up.
We should be informed citizens.
If it moves, kill it. If it doesn't move, burn it.
They ought to put on more westerns.
But it happened, just ripping off the people.
If you could just get the raise.
Listen, I'm guilty. I've done it.
Ice cream.
Stop the massacre.
Orthodontist.
Vietnam.
Deaths.
Kill me.
Tranquilizers.
Doing my job.
Idiot boss.
Burn the whole village.
We vote.
Just shoot the bastard.
Mother, TV's not fun anymore.
Well, we could make love.
Hmm?
Love. We could make love. You know.
Now?
Sure. Why not?
Mother, it's time for Carol Burnett.
What goes up must come down. Spinning wheel, got to go round.
We're going to Chino, reform prison. We're going to play for some people there.
Hey, that's Chino, huh?
What goes up must come down. Spinning wheel got to go round.
It's very, very hard to have a nine-piece band to really have a feeling of one.
This band, I believe, is nine very capable musicians who try to play music.
Very, very similar to being in either an eight-piece band or a ten-piece band. So the thing we did was, we all moved into the same house. In fact, it's a very small apartment. And we all decided to really think the same. We should all have the same religion. So the thing we did was, we all got involved in the RCA religion, it's called. And we all wear these now. And it's brought the band a lot closer together. It's a natural type of religion, because things are changing in such a way where everything has to be done in an economical way, an intelligent way, as to save time, amortize. And this is why we've all come to this conclusion that the RCA is the best religion for us. We're allowed to touch dials, knobs and dials. We can watch oscilloscopes and play with a lot of little resistors as games, but we can't really get into anything physical with each other. We can't get into anything really physical with our friends or relatives, especially relatives. We avoid any kind of a physical contact with our relatives because we feel very close to them in a different way.
We're not allowed to use reverb on Wednesdays.
Yeah, there is no reverb on Wednesdays. I really think that the fact that the kids of today are looking to the pop stars for a political concept is a very good idea, because who else is more qualified than a pop star who knows as much as he knows about politics?
That's why we can't get any work done.
Why is that?
Because of guys with comedians.
Because he's such a trickster and jokester.
There's a lot of sociological and political labels, even metaphysical labels, that get attached to a musician's music that he's not really concerned with himself, maybe not even aware of himself. And when you get knocked for that, it hurts, because it almost feels like that somebody's shooting at you personally. If your music is a whole lot of what you are, if somebody puts it down, it's you know, it's like taking 80% of your personality and slamming it.
Someone is waiting for you. Spinning wheel, spinning wheel. Drop all your trouble by the river side. Catch a painted pony on the spinning wheel.
We occasionally get a letter or two. Last year we got a pair of letters. We got one from a little girl asking for a picture of the group. And the other letter was from her father asking us please not to send that picture. This is a peculiar occupation where everything would be just hunky-dory in 1 minute, and then in the next minute, you try and figure out what happened. And the result of that, in most cases, of young musicians, is that they end up... Here's a perfect example for you.
Freddie.
Now, Freddie has a little box in his house where he puts all his money into. He carries it in his mouth, in his jowls, from place to place. No one knows it's there. And then he goes home, he sneaks in the back way, he covers my eyes, and he hides the money in this little box. So, because of the nature of our occupation, in summary, the thing that we try and do is not overdo it as far as throwing it away at one time on things that are logical. In fact, let me ask Fred about that. What exactly do you do with all your money?
I spend it.
Which means that everything I've said is a complete lie.
Charlotte, the North Carolina Jaycees, and the Charlotte Jaycees invite you to join them in a travel flight searching for the new 1972 Miss North Carolina.
They're so wholesome, so typical of what really is going on in young America today.
Like any other little girl, I always wanted to be Miss America because this was part of America and part of what every little girl should want to aspire to be. My name is Connie Lerner. I come from Asheville, and I am Miss North Carolina 1971.
I'm Dorothy Thurman from Fairfield, Connecticut.
I'm Tom Hensley from Jackson, Tennessee.
John Kelly, Roanoke, Virginia.
Pete Petropoulos, Greenville, South Carolina.
B.B. Shopwaring, Weston, Connecticut.
I'm H. Parks Helms, Executive Director of the 1971 Miss North Carolina pageant.
I'm Gene Warren, Assistant Producer of the pageant.
I'm Sam Cornwell, Assistant Director of the pageant.
I always wanted to be Miss America because this was part of America, and I knew that with that title comes a certain amount of power. By using that power, you can bring other people into better positions in life. You can make other people happy. You can do other things for people. Whereas something like a black armband does not command the immediate respect or attention that a crown does.
At Valley Forge, George Washington begged for supplies, finally asking, "Is anybody there? Does anybody care?" And John Adams stood and said, "By God, we're here, and we care."
There's a very nice bus line in the front panel, which the judges line.
There are three areas of judging in which a girl can score points. Number one is the area of swimsuit competition, which I personally feel is very important.
I expect this particular category causes more confusion among the judges than any other one aspect of it, because you're thinking about not only the beauty of form, but you're thinking about the posture, the girl, the complexion, the care she's given her skin, hairstyling, perhaps her bathing suit, and the way she walks to you, away from you, how she handles herself generally. This is what we're looking for in the swimsuit competition.
Then there's the second area of competition, and that is evening gown. In evening gown, a girl is judged on her poise, on her carriage, and really the type of dress she wears. Does it flatter her figure? Does she do something for the dress as well?
Walk very, very slowly. Just be yourself. And walk very, very slowly and make a gesture to both sides of the audience. Pause this way and this way. And then you take A firm stance on your back leg so that you're not going to be like this, so you're right ready to take off again. And then you look from both sides, and then you come back and you pause. Marbury, and now I'd like to see you walk down the runway and remember, be yourself. Don't be stiff. Just be yourself. Let's see how you did this. Very good.
You got him!
And then, of course, there's talent, and talent counts 50%. It's important because not only does a girl, first of all, have to look appealing and then sound appealing, she has to do things for other people. And I think by using her talent, she can share something that God has given her with other people.
Have very stringent regulations and rules which these girls must follow while they're here. Each girl is chaperoned. This year we have put a requirement that the chaperone be at least 28 years old and married. We provide lodging for them in an area that can be patrolled for their safety and to make sure that they are cared for in the kind of atmosphere that parents and grandparents would expect them to be.
Smiling is a very interesting part of the pageant. Many times a girl's smile will freeze, and sometimes the judges can't make up their mind, and your mouth begins to hurt, and your jaws begin to hurt, and you feel like just sinking through the floor. So I start to smile like a fluorescent light. And there's three phases. First, you smile a little bit, then maybe you brighten it a little, and then you really put it on.
They're so concerned for the other people around them and their lives and about what they want to do to give of themselves that it just has amazed us of this quality that they have. They're not just thinking of themselves.
I would say a girl would have to increase her wardrobe at least three times what she normally wears, and you've got to look your best all the time. I would say I have about almost 15 gowns. I would say I have probably 30 pairs of shoes as well.
The pageant not only chooses one girl every time to win, but they're giving an opportunity for every girl on that stage to find out who she is, where she wants to go.
Well, the primary purposes of the pageant is to provide scholarships for deserving and talented young ladies.
We feel particularly proud here in North Carolina that this year, the 1971 pageant, we will give $6,250 in scholarship to the winners here.
The cost of being in a pageant, I think, really should be understood before a girl enters a pageant. I started to figure it up a couple of times, and I stopped because I knew if I showed it to my father, he wouldn't believe it.
Not just the money, not just the clothes or the title, even in their local locale, but the kind of person that will make them a better person, a better individual, a better citizen, eventually a better wife and mother, which is what they were meant to be.
I want to continue with having a career, and I'd like to become an ambassador, possibly to a foreign country. And I knew that the title Miss America meant automatic position, automatic reputation, an automatic head start, although there is a lot of controversy on that topic today for this reason. People who are members of the Women's Liberation feel that this is not a worthy way of judging a girl.
Let's do a little trial run on what I feel like the judges might ask you as a contestant. What do you think of the women's liberation today?
I agree with it to a certain extent because I feel if a woman does a job which is equal to that of a man, I feel that she should receive an equal salary. But so far as the femininity, I agree with that. I think a woman should be a woman and a man a man.
How can you influence the lives of young children? Think a while, answer it as you will.
I think that probably the best way that I can influence the lives of young children is to set a good, a very good example.
What you do from now on will be
viewed by people across the state, and you will be in the public's eye, and the image that you create will be what is known as Miss North Carolina. I want to ask your parents if, at this time, if they have any questions or comments concerning her reign as Miss North Carolina of 1972.
I know.
Well, I would. Where yes, will she would. Stay at home?
Yes. She...
Bless your heart. That's a good thing.
She will stay at home.
As if she were not.
You're not going to lose a daughter. We're going to keep her mighty busy for a year.
I don't know if I have any questions because I feel like Patsy is now in mighty good hands. And I believe that with your help, all of your help and guidance, that she will be a success for you.
Can we get you to sign this thing now? And if you'll sign on the bottom line, Ms. Wood. Being an attorney, I want to say that this is somewhat like in preparing a lease. We always say that we will return it in the same condition as when received, usual wear and tear accepted.
I'm not scared of dying, and I don't really care. If it is you find him dying, well then, let the time be near. If it is you find him dying, and if dying time is near, I'm gonna hug my coffin, there's this cold out there, there's this cold out there, yeah, days and cold down there. And when I die, and when I'm gone, there'll be one child born in this world to carry on, carry on.
Talk to you about something that really turns me on. Tires. I call myself a tireologist. There aren't too many of us around. Most of you get into tires only when you're shopping for new ones. Well, with me, it isn't a passing need or a dilettantish hobby. I champion bias belted. I adore polyester. And when people compliment me on my nylons, I know it's not my legs they're admiring, but my wheels. What was it the poet wrote? The fog comes in on little tiger paws. And it does. The fog comes in on tiger paws, power cushion polyglass, fast track glass belted, steel belted radial plies. Pick a tire, any tire. Can you tell which is better? You can't, I can. Let's take a test. Which is the best? Can you guess by the name how the tire companies rate these tires? Which is the premium? First line, second line, and third line. Is it Firestone's Champion, Goodyear's Rally, Goodrich's Lifesaver, or General's Jet Air 3? Let's hear it. Which one? All nice-looking tires. Pretty tires. You couldn't tell by the tread. You can't tell which one will corner better, stop shorter, wear longer. One company's premium may be as good as another's first line. When you look at a tire, what you get is the name and the salesman's word. Hmm? Take my word. The only way to rate a tire is on durability, safety, and all-around performance. Not by the look or the advertised name. It's by becoming an expert, by paying your dues and putting in your years. Okay, here's the answer to the test. In this group, the premium tire is Goodrich's Lifesaver. First line, from Ohio, Goodyear's Rally. Also from Ohio, General's Jet Air III. And in this corner, the loser, it's Firestone's champion of the lowest rated third line tire. Sorry, champ. Hey, I got another question. Now, can you tell me which department of government in 1966 was directed by Public Law 89563 to come up with a uniform grading system for passenger car tires? Question two. Which department of government since 1966 has still not come up with a uniform grading system for passenger car tires? The answer is the Department of Transportation. Let me tell you what the real problem with buying tires is. No one has set grading standards for the tire industry. One company's first line may or may not be superior to another company's second line. Do you know, are all premium line tires the same? Does a radial ply tire have a superior stopping ability, cornering ability, better traction? If it does, why doesn't the Department of Transportation say so? Does the rayon cord tire give you longer mileage than the polyester corded tire? Are either puncture resistant? You can see why so many people make mistakes, end up paying more and replacing every 10,000 miles. And I can see why people buy because they like the white walls, or because somebody told them that the white raised letters on the side is definitely the look of the 70s. That's an incredible reason for buying a product your life depends upon. If you have any questions about tires that could save your life, drop a note to the Department of Transportation. If you have any questions about the history of tires, ask me. Here, let me ask you. Who invented the pneumatic tire? Where, when, and for what reason? What did his son say? Here's the answer. John Dunlop, an Irish veterinarian in Dublin, invented the pneumatic tire in 1888 for his son's bicycle. His son said, thanks, Dad. See, you thought I was going to say time to retire, didn't you? But I'm always full of surprises. Catch me for something sneaky next time.
Librarian here for a good many years.
I'm Bob Campbell, mayor of Lebanon, Indiana, the population of 10,000, the friendliest city in the state of Indiana.
My name is Owen Hansen. I'm managing editor of the Lebanon Reporter.
My name is Jim Stout. I'm chief of police here at Lebanon, Indiana.
I'm Don Hives, principal here at Lebanon Senior High School.
My name is Reverend Homer J. Hunsinger. I'm the minister of this church, which is the First United Church of Christ, located at 701 North Lebanon Street here in Lebanon, Indiana.
Here, Lynn. Two, three, off you want.
The political makeup of the county is arch-conservative. This is one of the few counties that went so heavily for Barry Goldwater.
Hi, Judge. How are you? Nice to see you. Judge Johnson just stepped out there. This area is a very conservative area in politics. I would say that we're doing a more, both units, Democrats and Republicans, work together real well, and we're real happy to...
God, don't shoot him!
Hi, Mr. Wyatt, how are you? Nice to see you. Hi, really.
It's not an activist Republican society. I would say that probably the John Birch Society here maybe numbers four or five people. I do believe, however, it's a thinking conservative element that supports the government, is against the anti-war demonstrations, that has its main worry in law and order.
We don't have any, or haven't as yet had any demonstrations. We have no racial problems here.
No, we don't have protests and demonstrations. I'm proud of our student body. They have performed well, and I've been very happy with them. We feel we have an excellent facility here, and the students make it that way. We have not had the protests and demonstrations. Sure, we have questions. I think as long as you treat a student fairly, a boy or girl fairly, then he'll treat you the same way.
The library's been here since practically 1905, but I haven't been here quite that long. But we have all the bestsellers. Dr. Rubin's book, What You've Always Wanted to Know About Sex, and Sensuous Woman. Oh, we just keep them under the counter, and sometimes we put a little skull and crossbones under on the card. And they're just for adults who would not disapprove. They read these. So many of the books on the bestseller list are those that we can't put on the open shelf. But people want to read them. And the boy and myself feel that this is a tax-supported unit, and we should have the books that people want to read. And we censor very, very little.
Our problems here in Lebanon deals a lot with the juveniles, their drinking, a few dope problems, the traffic problems. I've been on here over 18 years, and we've had one murder. That was about 6 years ago.
The ethnic makeup is pretty well one unit, and that's white Protestants. We have perhaps 8 or 10 colored families in town. We have maybe 50 from the Italian heritage.
We in the past years have been averaging about 42% of our graduating seniors who will go on to some college or university or some school of some sort.
The sending away to college and the returning is one of the sad things of this little town and probably all little towns in America. We send a heck of a majority, or a good percentage, I should say, of our graduating seniors off to college, Purdue, Indiana, and they just never seem to find themselves back here again.
Basically, I would say our church is fundamentalist. We say take the Bible and read it, live it prayerfully according to the dictates of your own conscience. We believe there's a heaven to gain and a hell to shun. We believe that Christ is the Savior, and very fundamental along those lines, I would say.
We don't have too much of a drug situation in our enrollment here. Of course, we hear about this. We know that, I should say we don't know, we think that we have drugs here, as we do have, I'm certain, in surrounding areas, and we have some here, I think.
We have some, no problem, but as a whole, I'd say it isn't a big problem. It's the drinking of beer and alcoholic beverages.
Hey, Dave.
Good
you? Evening. Nice to see you. Yes.
Where's the bar?
Hi, how are you? Nice to see you.
But I'm interested in staying in a town that gives me license to say something. It isn't always easy to say something. I'm probably one of the few people that in Lebanon that have ever been blackballed out of the Kiwanis Club.
our library, we've done over. We have carpeting. We have beautiful ceilings and lighting. And, air conditioning. We have everything anybody wants, including the books.
We have fine homes in our town, and well-groomed town. I think we have the cleanest town in the state of Indiana.
Our biggest worries and our biggest issues and our biggest concerns aren't in Washington. It's here in Lebanon, Indiana.
Does anyone know who said death is nature's way of telling you to slow down?
I want to go simply when I go.
Skiddly-doo-wah, skiddly-doo-wah.
They'll give me a simple funeral there, I know.
Spelling out rest in peace.
Oh, take me when I'm gone to Forest Hall.